Welcome to church on this beautiful day. Welcome to worship. If you're here in person or online, we just greatly appreciate that you're with us today. We have a few announcements before we get started. We are still doing our preschool school supply drive. The tub is over in Fellowship Hall, so come fellowship with us after church and drop those off. Also in Fellowship Hall, we have wrap that is starting up very soon here on September 7th. How do we live a life of peace in these uncertain times? And that's the area we're focusing on during the first block of wrap. So that starts on September 7th, which is a Wednesday at 5:30. Let's see what else is going on. We have our children's choir program restarting. We have two programs starting up. One that will meet on rehearse on Wednesday at 4:45, I think, in the choir room. And then on Sunday, right before Sunday school for the kiddos. So two choir opportunities for the kids. It's been a couple of years, hasn't it? So it'll be great to hear those praise voices again during worship time. Let's see, what else do we have going here? We have a very special announcement. We have a rose here on the communion table. Anyone know typically what the rose signifies? A baby, a new baby. So yes, Kevin and Jessica Reeves now have a new daughter. So it's awesome. She was born on Friday, the 19th. So congratulations to them. Also congratulations to Dan and Linda grandparents, and James and Laura great-grandparents. So let's give them a hand. Wonderful. So I think that's all the announcements we have set for today. So let's prepare our hearts, souls, and mind to worship our God as I make my way over here for the call to worship. Like clay in the potter's hands, so are we to you, O Lord.
You take the ordinary and offer them imperfect, and make something beautiful, molding us.
In your hands we are made new, perfected, Lord, by you.
In your hands we are made useful to the service for you. Amen.
Amen. So let us rise in body and spirit as we join in hymn 307, God of Grace and God of Glory.
Join me in the prayer of confession. You created the earth whole and round. You created us to be whole people. But we have become fragmented, cracked, and broken. We have been broken by false promises, lost relationships, shattered trust. We have become cracked with the experience of systemic sin, prejudice, oppression, and fear. We have become fragmented, building up walls instead of knitting hands. Forgive us when we have done the breaking. Heal us where we have been hurt. Let your light shine through our cracks and scars, so that we might bring the light to the world. showing that in you we are made whole. In you we find healing. In you we find renewed life. Help us to forgive, to love, to mend. Amen. The assurance of pardon. God is the potter. We are the clay. When we are cracked and broken, God helps to bring us back together. Sometimes we don't feel the same afterwards, but God uses every piece and offers us the newness of life to begin again. Amen.
Who am I that the God of all grace wipes the tears from
But this time we're going to have a time of children. I don't see any children out there. How about those who are kids at heart? We're going over to the pray and play area. We're going to have some fun with clay today. Yourself to what's in here. All right, so what are different things we can make or do? Let's start with that. What different things we can do with clay? Mold it, share. I like that, share. I learned a long time ago, how many people remember watching Mr. Rogers? Yeah, what did Mr. Rogers say we can do with clay when we're frustrated? Squeeze it, slam it. Do get rid of all our frustrations. So let's do that together on a count of three. One, two, three, let's slam it. Yeah, this is the only time I'm allowing noise in the pray and play area, right? And there's my son Matthew. Come on down, Matthew, just in time. We're playing with clay. What different things can we build with clay? A house, we can build a house. We can build a donut. I wouldn't advise eating that, little boy. Have to talk to your parents about that, Carol. Wouldn't be the first time. You're making a dinosaur. You can make a plate. Here we go, buddy. You want to play with that clay? Yeah. What are different things you can make with clay, Matthew? Yeah, you can make, I heard, a house. You can make animals. You can make a ball. And what are we making there, Kyle? A brontosaurus. Big dinosaur. Yeah. Well, the cool thing about clay, we have a individual at the potter's house. What's a potter, by the way? Someone who makes pots out of clay. Yeah. So Jeremiah, a prophet, was called by God at a very young age. He was called by the Lord to go to the potter's house. And one thing about a potter is very skilled, and he's usually at a wheel molding his clay, right, and making it into a vessel, whatever it might be. But if he makes a mistake, what does the potter typically do? Anyone? Slams it down. Starts all over again, starts fresh, doesn't he? And starts molding that clay over again, doesn't he? That's the way it is with God's love for us. No matter how much, I like that person there, no matter how much we mess up in life or mess up with our clay, you know, the way God looks at it is, take that clay, slam it down again, and restart. That is the ultimate love that God has for each and every one of us. Where we are the slab of clay, and God helps to mold us and guide us by living through his word and scripture, and by us worshiping together and the values that Jesus taught in his ministry and parables. God loves us, and we can continue working on our piece of art that we call life throughout our life. I like that, Matthew. What is that?
A chicken.
A chicken, yeah. Why did the chicken cross the road?
It's not a chicken.
Oh.
No, it's a chicken.
Very good. Let us pray. God, be in my head. God, be in my heart. God, be on my left. God, be on my right. God, be beneath me. God, be above me. God be upon the faces of all those around me who love me. And God does love us and remolds us every day. Amen. All right, thank you guys for coming forward. You can continue playing with clay.
Join me in the prayer for illumination. All scripture carries God's spirit and vitality. It blesses us with instruction and inspiration, conviction, guidance, and strengthening in all things gracious and just. Today's scripture can be found in your pew Bibles in the Old Testament on page 629. I will be reading from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 18, verses 1 through 11. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord: "Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was working of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me: "Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I have intended to bring on it. And at another moment, I may declare concerning a nation or kingdom that I will build and plant it. But if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will change my mind about the good that I had intended to do to it. Now therefore say to the people, O Judah, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus say the Lord, look, I am the potter, shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you, from your evil way and amend your ways and your doings. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Robert. Let's be in an attitude of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Many years ago, I recall sitting at a potter's wheel, molding a slab of clay into a beautiful piece of art. Now, as I began to sculpt the clay, I vividly recall the cold, damp sensation upon my fingers as the wheel began to turn. The iciness was compared to the first swim of the season in the summer at the beach. Yes, the texture was startling at first, but my body soon became acclimated and accustomed to it. Now, I found the scent of the clay as plain and earthly, with an unmistakable freshness to it. My hands moved up and down the figure-forming clay with much effort in order to attempt to compensate the pressure of my hands with that velocity of the wheel going around and around. But then suddenly something happened. That wheel started accelerating to such a fast pace that I couldn't keep up the right amount of pressure on my vessel. Now, this led to an unfortunate chain of events and actually ended up being pretty messy reaction to not only the clay and the water compound all over me, but also the surrounding environment of the retextured floors and walls. You can imagine it was quite a sight to see. And this left me with the perplexing question to my instructor, what happened? Now, I'm sure at one point or another, you worked with clay. I hope your experience was not as extreme as mine. That's why I'm glad I didn't have a wheel over there in the pray and play area. Yes, clay can be messy, however, in the right skilled hands, it can become a beautiful piece of sculptured art and also a functional component. We're experiencing exciting times here at FPC as we are in this interim season of remolding ourselves to renew and revitalize ministries. So come with me to the Potter's House as we see how the prophet Jeremiah can be our guide to remold the opportunities ahead of us. The prophet Jeremiah uses the vivid illustration of a potter at his potter's wheel. This is not the first time in biblical literature we used clay or a potter as metaphors. So we recall early in Genesis, God was thought of as a potter who created life from clay. The image of God as potter is also found in Isaiah 64:8. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father, and we are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. There are other texts illustrating God as potter, but the one we're focusing upon today is our friend Jeremiah. Who is this man named Jeremiah who has a book in the Old Testament with his namesake? Jeremiah was a faithful prophet of God who prided himself to be obedient as well as disciplined in prayer. Jeremiah's prophetic life was predestined just within the first few words of his book. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nation. Now, like many individuals called upon God, Jeremiah was just a child. And basically, at this point, he's like, I'm just a child. I don't have the word. So he put on the proverbial brakes and said that to God. I'm just a boy. But when God calls anyone, God is pretty persistent, isn't he? And doesn't give up. So here marks the start of Jeremiah's prophetic work and ministry. What is so interesting about Jeremiah was that he tells more about himself and struggles than any other biblical prophet that we know. Jeremiah resided in the city of Jerusalem during very challenging times, to say the least. These were the final years of the Judean kingdom, which had fallen in the hands of the Babylonians. The prophet and his people were struggling with their defeat, as well as knowing the suffering and destruction could have been preventable only if God's commands were obeyed. So imagine the frustration and anxiety Jeremiah experienced to come to the realization that the destruction of his homeland could have been preventable. So was it in vain? Fortunately, the remarkable characteristic of Jeremiah was he was also focused on the possibility of restoration and bringing back the cherished Davidic rule. It is the hope of God's restoring grace, which is the silver lining which we're focusing upon today. Our text has God instructing Jeremiah to visit a potter's house so he can receive a message concerning the people of Judea. It was thought that the potter's house was situated on the banks of the Hermon Valley, which is south of Jerusalem. We know the soil of this region was rich in water and clay. To understand the potter's illustration, we should know the word potter in Hebrew is yosha, which translates to one who forms or fashions. The context of the word commonly can be used for making pottery or clay, as we saw over there today, or God's creation of humans and animals, as we see in Genesis. As Jeremiah entered the potter's house, he witnessed a man behind the wheel already engaged in designing a vessel. As the potter diligently worked the clay, it failed to render the shape the potter desired. So did the potter throw the clay in the scrap heap? No. On the contrary, Jeremiah witnessed the potter recycle that same piece of clay. He did not hesitate, but rolled that clay back into a ball and what? Began remolding it again. So take note, the amount of power the potter had over that clay. At no point did the potter's hands lose control over the clay. The potter was a master and flawless in his skill. The only imperfection he experienced was the spoiled clay, which was quickly regenerated to something new and pleasing to him. The initial flaws of the spoiled vessel had everything to do with the clay and not the error of the potter. As Jeremiah marveled at the potter's work, he heard the voice of the Lord informing him how much like the potter who restarted the clay vessel, God can also remold Judah from scratch. Who were responsible for Judah's destruction? Does the fault fall on God? Or does it fall on Judah? Upon the first glance of the text, one might wonder how God can be so vengeful and evil. Why would God want to destroy the chosen people, which he so diligently worked so hard to get out of exile? Why would God want to blot out anyone created in God's own image? Where is the grace? Where is the loving God who adopted these refugees without a home in the time of Moses? So I started to look deeper into the text and discovered it's not about a wrathful and vengeful God, rather a very concerned God, which can be compared to that of a loving parent. The glimmer of hope is found when God provides Judah a chance to reprieve from their bad behavior and repent. The metaphor of the potter illustrates how God would rather remold the Judeans instead of obliterating them, as was done early on in the Genesis flood narrative. Much like a parent who firmly instructs the child out of harm's way, God has set into motion rules and expectations to correct their bad behaviors. I recall many years ago, Heather and I enjoyed watching the TV reality show Super Nanny. This is a show about a British nanny who comes to the rescue to a home of a troubled family. The featured families usually had difficulties with misbehaving children, which often was the reflection of the parenting technique, right? How many remember watching the show? Yeah. The female nanny named Jo Frost would initially observe the abnormal behavior. She would then go to work and come up with a game plan to resolve the issues, to put everything into motion by walking the parents and children through it together. Joe would initially use positive reinforcements with the child, and if that failed, she used what she called the naughty chair to stop and reset the child's behavior. I see the Supermanny's visit similar to the potter's illustration. Like the potter, the nanny has the skill to mold children to appropriate behavior by using constructive discipline with follow-through. The nanny does not resort to any form of corporal punishment, which can have destructive results. Rather, she engages to change the child's behavior through the expectations and rules and follow-through and punishment with the naughty chair, only if necessary. Child will soon discover they have a choice, and if they misbehave, there will be constructive consequences. Much like the potter who will reuse the same piece of clay, the parent can use the child's misbehavior to teach them what is acceptable and not. In the text, God provided the Judeans an opportunity to shape up from their misbehavior and announce if they fail to comply, there will be a punishment. For God gave the Judeans every opportunity to change. We see in Jeremiah 18:8, if the nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evils, I will change my mind about the disaster I intended to bring upon it. So the last thing God wanted to do was to hurt people. God's initial desire was that of concern and wanting the best for God's people. Unfortunately, the Judeans did not comply to God, and eventually their ill fate rested in their own hands. In life, when we discover the consequence of our own behavior, we need to be assured that God does not love us any less. For God, my friends, is love. As Christians, what are we to do with this text? It's very complex. I admit the love and grace of God provided in the text is very different than what we are accustomed to seeing in the New Testament. That's it. We should understand that we are in the Old Testament working with the original covenant of God to the Israelites. In the perspective of a Jewish audience, Jeremiah may represent life as guided by the Torah in order to defeat evil in the world. Even though the Jewish theology leaves open ample space for repentance, there is a flip side that when the Israelites failed to obey, a punishment came forth. So as Christians, our grace is represented through the suffering of Jesus, where we see Christ's unconditional grace without a price. Do I have an amen to that? The extent of this grace is spelled out in John 1:16. From Christ's fullness, we all receive grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. We can count on Christ because he represents the ultimate potter who provides us new opportunities and chances even when we don't think we deserve it. The grace we are provided is immeasurable, for our human minds cannot fathom it completely. What we do know is no matter how often we fail, that olive branch of grace is always extended. So when Peter asked Jesus, if a member of the church sins against you, how often times should I forgive? As many as seven times? What did Jesus say? No, not seven times, but 77 times. We are in a season of change here at FPC. We have an opportunity of remolding ourselves by re-envisioning our ministry opportunities. Next Saturday in this place is our presbytery big event where Dr. Sean Chow will lead us on an exploration of revitalization. For the clay that is set before us has many ministry possibilities and opportunities and can be molded and shaped in a variety of different ways. As we allow the Spirit to move us, let us free us from any limitations that might spoil the clay. Let us prayerfully enter this time with an openness and willingness to accept change, new and exciting opportunities upon the horizon here. The loving potter known as Christ is at the wheel, making something old into something new. Are you ready, friends? Amen. Let us remain seated and sing our hymn of affirmation, Change My Heart, O God. It will be a video on the screen. What's been an attitude of prayer? Gracious, loving God, we come to you as we prepare for the week ahead to reset our hearts, souls, and minds, for there are so many things that can lead us astray. In these chaotic times, it is so easy to lose sight of you, to comprehend that we are not in control, for you're the potter and we're merely clay. Mold us to do your will and serving one another in your name. We come to you to remember we are your people and you are our God. For you're all about love, and we need to profess and live that love out as your Son, Jesus, molded for us. Encourage us to surrender to you, to be mindful of your presence. At this hour, we lift up our prayers of joys, sorrows, concerns to you, Lord. We pray for the universal church that we find common ground in your name, for the continued healing of the earth and all the incredible natural resources you provided. For human rights, for the oppressed and the voiceless. For our governmental leaders, guide them, lead them, and govern with integrity. The mission of this church, that may we live out the way that you love us. Guide our church leadership during the big event on Saturday, and through this interim season, open us to the ministry opportunities ahead. Provide healing and reassurance for those who are ill, for those who are recovering. Provide patience and strength. Wash over those who are dealing with any sort of mental illness, Lord, and struggles. It has such a stigma in our society. Guide them and direct them, Lord. Guide those who are experiencing grief, that they may be guided by your redeeming light during the dark night of the soul. We pray for relationships, broken promises, and financial struggles. Let us not forget to celebrate the Thanksgiving and joys in our life, such as the recent birth of Declan Reeves. For you not only hold our hand during these times of struggles, you leap for joy during our happy moments, Lord. So now in the silence, we lift up our prayers that are upon our hearts, God. Lift up all these prayers to your care and abide in love that you offered. Now, as a people, we share in the prayer that you taught your disciples to say, and we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. let us gather in our hearts and minds the gifts which is to present to the Lord at this time. We now prepare for the morning offering. Lord, we offer these gifts to you with thankful hearts in joyous praise. As we give our money and our resources, we surrender our whole beings to you in worship and adoration. Amen. Now let us close in our closing hymn, God, the Sculptor of the Mountains. Rise. Let us prepare for the benediction as we go out into the world, knowing that God is indeed the potter and we are just merely clay. Surrender to God and love one another in his name, and that we pray. Amen.
Amen.